Ikhtibar. Tonight is the Majlis. Maulana Imam Ali As-Sajjad, Ruhi Lahul Fida. And much as we refer to him as Marid Karbala, ulama of the past have shown us, and history in itself has proven across the generations, that hajat are accepted, and those that are suffering from ailments, from sicknesses, the wasila and the tawassul of Imam As-Sajjad has provided them with shifa'a. And inshallah, this wasila of Imam Sajjad would also be a form of shafa'a in the akhirah. If we can start this Majlis Mubarak by reciting Ayat Shifa five times, imploring and seeking by the wasila of Mawlana Imam Sajjad for all of those mu'mineen and mu'minat who are not in the best of health. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir la'inir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ اللهم إنا نسألك باسمك الأعظم يا الله يا الله يا الله يا الله يا الله بعلي 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 يا الله. By the sake of Mawlana Imam Ali ibn al-Husayn Zainul Abideen, mu'mineen and mu'minat who are not in the best of health, you grant them shafa'a ya Allah. By the sake of the grief of Imam Zainul Abideen, when he walked through the market of Shah, ya Allah, grant the mu'mineen and mu'minat who are not in the best of health shifa'a in the fastest time, ya Allah. Ya Allah, grant us the tawfiq to perform the ziyarah of Imam Ali As-Sajjad in Jannatul Baqi. Ya Allah, show us the day where we will come crawling to the haram with a golden qubba over the grave of Imam Ali As-Sajjad. Ya Allah, grant us the honor of the intercession of Imam As-Sajjad on the day when the eyes will be full of fear, when the hearts are with terror and the lips are thirsty. On that day of judgment, ya Allah, cool our eyes, our hearts and our lips with the intercession of Imam Ali ibn al-Husayn Zainul Abideen. Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir la'inir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. الحمد لله بارئ الخلائق الأجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء حبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم محمد
الله. ثم الصلاة والسلام على أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين لا سيما ولي الله الحجة ابن الحسن صاحب الأمر والزمان. روحي وأرواح العالمين له الفدا ولعنة الله على أعدائهم وعلى غاصبي حقوقهم وعلى من شرك في ولايتهم وعلى منكري فضائلهم من الأولين والآخرين إلى قيام يوم الدين آمين رب العالمين. صلى الله عليك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله صلى الله عليك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة يا غريب الغرباء يا مظلوم كربلاء السلام على من جعل الله الشفاء في تربته السلام على من الإجابة تحت قبته السلام على ساكن كربلاء فيا ليتنا ثم يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي يا سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، قال مولانا رسول الله وهو أشرف الأنبياء صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم أفضل الجهاد كلمة حق عند السلطان الجائر. صدق النبي وآمنا به. زينوا مجالسكم بذكر محمد وآل محمد. أحبائي، you find that the period in which Maulana Imam Ali ibn al-Husayn Zainul Abideen Ruhi Lahu al-Fida began to execute the role as the Hujjah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth was perhaps one of the most darkest periods of Islamic history. And it would not be an exaggeration to say that this was perhaps one of the darkest periods within human history in itself, because the dhulm and the jawr and the oppression of Bani Umayyah had spread wide and beyond the boundaries of the Islamic Empire. There were a number of attacks and a number of invasions within neighboring countries within the Arabian Peninsula and out of the Arabian Peninsula, quest for territory, campaigns that were led by Bani Umayyah in the name of Islam, but had nothing to do with deen in its entirety. And you find that it is within this dark moment in time that Imam Sajjad undertakes the divine leadership, the divine role of leading this ummah and ensuring that the pure teachings of Islam are not obliterated from the face of this earth. And sarahatan, when you look at Islamic history, the jihad and the tribulations of each and every one of the imams is unique. But you find that when it comes to the jihad and when it comes to the trials and the tribulations of Imam al-Sajjad, it would not be an exaggeration without compromising the hurmah of any one of the remaining a'immah that the period of Imam al-Sajjad was a period of darkness that perhaps no other imam has seen. Starting from the day and the moment in which Imam al-Sajjad began executing the role of the Hujjatullah fil Ard, Yom Ashura, the imamate of Imam Sajjad begins, and it begins with what type of a trial and what type of a tribulation. His imamate begins with the head of Sayyid al-Shuhada being raised on a spear. His imamate begins with the trampling of the body of Sayyid al-Shabab Ahlil Jannah. His imamate begins with the burning of the tents. And when you analyze the biography of Sayyid al-Sajideen, it is important over here that we acknowledge the position of Imam Zainul Abideen on the day of Ashura. And I will take a moment over here to bring light to the stances of Imam Sajjad, stances of bravery that the books of history have neglected and time has neglected for a number of reasons. And you find that Ahibai, the popular narrative, Tabihu, be with me on this. Popular narrative throughout a number of years has stipulated that Imam Zainul Abideen Ruhillahul Fida was overcome with intense sickness. And as a result of this sickness that was so intense, the Imam was barely able to move. And it is for the reason of this sickness that Imam Sajjad was not able to participate in the war on the day of Ashura. You find that this is the popular narrative that is commonly recited or commonly given to the masses. And when you come and you look into the books of history and you try and research further into what was the sickness of Imam Sajjad, you will find that those historians who are at the payroll or who are within the payroll of the ulama, those ulama who are on the payroll of the Umayyad government and who are writing history as per the whims and the dictations of Bani Abbas, did not spare any effort to humiliate Imam Sajjad when it came to writing about what type of sickness Imam Sajjad had. If you were to look through the books of history and you ask what was the sickness of Imam Ali Zainul Abideen that was so intense he was not able to participate on the day of Ashura in jihad, some of the reasons that are written in the books of history, personally, I don't see them as being worthy of being mentioned on the pure minbar of Imam al-Hussein. But in any case, it is important in your journey of ma'rifah, ma'rifah of Imam Sajjad, know who is this Hujjatullah fil Ardh that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appointed for you and whose Farsh Aza you have come to sit at today. You will find that contrary to the popular narrative, if you were to return to the books of history and you were to research through perhaps one of the most ancient and one of the first writings that recorded the incident of Ashura, you will find that Imam Zainul Abideen alayhi salam actually played a crucial role on the day of Ashura and participated in the battle on the day of Ashura. Lahidu. Before we come and we warrant this premise with a historical reference, let me mention something for you, Bain al-Kawsain. We open the bracket, we close it, and we move. Ahibai Yom Ashura, unlike what a person may perceive, that you have an army of 30,000 immediate warriors on the battlefield from within the army of Umar ibn Sa'ad, and you have 72 men, 72 generals, and there are a number who came and joined the army of Imam al-Hussein, such that historical accounts narrate that 145 companions altogether, 72 from the Qadha, from the generals, bila shakin wala raib. But it was not that you had 30,000 men come and attack 145 men, and in the span of 1 hour, the battle was finished. Abadan la. Sayyid al-Shuhada was martyred, as they say, at the time of Salatul Asr. Yani Asr, because you know within our Sharia, and even within the timings of the Salat, which is stipulated within the Quran, we have three major times for Salat. More five, joining the Salat is the Asl, and separating the Salat is by Tasamuh, as is mentioned within the books of Fiqh. In any case, when we use this istilah or this term Salatul Asr, ya'ani, an expression of an hour or two before Salatul Maghrib. Fasawwiru, ahibai, yom Ashura, you have 72 men who are surrounded by a marauding army fully equipped to the bone, 30,000 of them. You have 72 courageous men, the likes of whom the world has not seen, stand up in battle against them for more than 8 to 9 hours. Sayyidina Shuhada became Shaheed at the time of Salah, an hour or two, as we said, before Salatul Maghrib. For it is important for you to understand the context and have an understanding of what happened on the day of Ashura, Ahibai. After Salatul Fajr, Imam al-Hussein arranged his army into three ranks. You have the center flank with the Bani Hashim, and the commander-in-chief and the flag bearer of this army, Mawlana Qamar Bani Hashim Abul Fadl al-Abbas, with the flag of Islam flying high above his shoulders. The Imam is then placed together in a format, a right wing and a left wing. The right wing is under the command of Zuhair ibn al-Kain, and the left wing is under the command of Mawlana Sheikh al-Ansar Habib ibn Madahir. Imam al-Hussein goes into the battlefield in the morning after Salatul Fajr, delivers two khutbas to the kuffar. You have within the maktal that Zuhair goes and delivers a khutbah. Burair goes and delivers a khutbah. When none of these sermons had any impact on the hearts or the souls of the enemies, the war began actually on the day of Ashura with a single one-on-one combat. And the first person nominated by Sayyid al-Shuhada from the camp of Islam and the camp of Jannah, the Muhammadi camp, was a companion by the name of Abdullah ibn Umair al-Kalbi. He went and represented in the first battle of the day, the first sword to be drawn. It was a single one-on-one duel. Abdullah ibn Umair represents the camp of Imam al-Hussein. Victory was registered for Imam al-Hussein, and after Imam al-Hussein's camp, physical victory, we're saying. On after the single duel or the single combat, Imam al-Hussein sent out his companions in formations of four. Four warriors, four horsemen in a format, systematically disciplined manner, marching forward and pushing back the ranks of the kuffar. The first four from the companions of Imam al-Hussein were known as companions by the name of Majma, Sa'ad, Jabir, and Amr. They pushed forward the army as they retreated. And in fact, I again, bracket between a bracket, don't lose track of our main thought. You have within the Makatil, in fact, At-Tabari mentions this. These four soldiers who were marching forward on their horses, they pushed back the enemy ranks so much on the day of Ashura. Umar ibn Sa'ad called out and said, separate between the four men. Because as a formation marching forward with full discipline, they also provided cover for each other. So they couldn't be attacked from the back. Umar ibn Sa'ad said, separate between them. 30,000 men, they sent a contingency of 1,000 to attack and separate between these four courageous warriors. They ended up in four different parts of the battlefield. At-Tabari says at that point, فَنَادَ الْحُسَيْنَ الْعَبَّاسِ. Imam al-Hussein called out to Abu al-Fadl Abbas to go and rescue them from the battlefield. And this is the first time on the day of Ashura that the enemy saw what the sword of Abu al-Fadl would look like. Even the poetry that he recites at that time, Allahu Akbar, gives you goosebumps. Analladhi u'rafu inda zamjara bi ibn al-Haydara. I am the one who is known amongst the roaring lions as the son of Haydar. Tahdeed, one person is going to save four and pushed back an entire army. Sawwaru, Abu al-Fadl says to them, Fathbitu lana al-yawm ya ahl al-kafara. If you have the heart and the courage, then stand forward in front of us today. Four men come back, Abu al-Fadl rescues them. Two men go out again in war. The two people who went in a dual format to push back the army, Zuhair ibn al-Kain and Hur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi. And it is at that point, Shimar al-La'in says to Umar ibn Sa'ad that these men in their individual battles are going to rout us and move, send our army to annihilation. Which is then at the first time that you had a mass attack under the command of Amr ibn Hajjaj attacking the right wing. When they couldn't attack the right wing sustained itself, they had to retreat. When they retreated, the left wing under Shimr bin Dhiljosh and Al-La'in came and attacked. The left wing established itself, so they had to retreat. Second time they attacked the right wing, which is when Muslim ibn Awsajah became Shaheed. And after this, there was a general attack. And even within that general attack, the army of Imam al-Hussein pushed back and companions went on single combats, pushing the army forward until the time of Bani Hashim came. And even within the Bani Hashim, there are those who went in single combats and there are those from the Bani Hashim who Imam al-Hussein sent as groups within a disciplined format to push back the enemy. فَلَا تَصَوَّرُوا that Karbala was a battle basita, that just four in the time of Salatul Fajr, 30 men came and in one whip. La, men who have achieved military feats that perhaps the world has not seen till this day and age. For within the different stages of the battle on the day of Ashura, you have the participation of Imam al-Sajjad, Ruhi Lahul Fida. Shufu, you find within the historical texts a narration that is narrated by Fudail ibn Zubayr al-Rassan al-Kufi. Fudail ibn Zubayr al-Rassan within, I will give you a very brief understanding of who he is from the books of Rijal, even though perspective of Rijal is not needed over here because there are enough external Qara'in. In any case, we'll park that topic on the side. For you to understand the credibility of the person who is narrating the role of Imam al-Sajjad or the participation of Imam al-Sajjad in battle on the day of Ashura. The narrator is, as we said, Ibn Zubayr al-Rassan, Fudail Ibn Zubayr al-Rassan. In Rijal al-Barqi and Rijal al-Kishi, these are two books of Ilm al-Rijal that are heavily depended upon by almost all ulama within the school of the Imamiyya Madhab. Within the books of Barqi and Kishi, it is narrated that Fudayl ibn Zubayr was one of the most credible companions of Imam al-Baqir and Imam al-Sadiq. And he has a text which he authored during the time of Imam al-Baqir and the time of Imam al-Sadiq, where he listed down the name of the shuhadas and the role of those who were shaheed with Imam al-Husayn on the day of Ashura. Narration is qadimi, coming from the time of Imam al-Baqir or Imam al-Sadiq. The narrator is somebody who is approved and who is praised by al-Barqi and by Kishi. More than that, you find that a person like Fudayl ibn Zubayr al-Rayyan, you find his name within the sanad, within the chain of narrators, in some of the hadith of Kamilu Ziyarat, within the text Kamilu Ziyarat, authored by Sheikh ibn Kaulaway, rahmatullah alayh. Sheikh ibn Kaulaway is the teacher of Sheikh Mufid, buried at the doorstep of Mawlana Imam al-Kadhim and Imam al-Jawad. Ruhi lahum al-fida. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Ibn Kaulaway, in his introduction to the book Kamilu Ziyarat, and is vetted by a number of contemporary maraja, is a book at the highest level of i'tibar, because Ibn Kaulaway paid the highest level of attention to the chain of narrators for every hadith that is mentioned inside of Kamilu Ziyarat. You find him inside this chain of narrators. So you understand from here, he has a stamp of thika even from Ibn Kaulaway, who was perhaps one of the most staunchest ulama of Rijal during his time, for those who know Ibn Kaulaway. Fudayl, now you understand that the person who is conveying this narration is at the highest level of authenticity. Fudayl ibn Zubayr al-Rassan mentions in regards to Imam al-Sajjad, Kana Ali ibn al-Husayn alilan, wakad istutta, wakad hadara ba'd al-kital. He's talking about the day of Ashura. Wakad hadara ba'd al-kital. Fadafa Allahu anhu, wa ukhida ma'an nisa. The last part I'm paraphrasing. Ukhida ma'an nisa. Fudayl goes on to say that in regards to Ali ibn al-Husayn Zain al-Abideen, yes, he was suffering from an ailment. Waqad irtutha. I will come to the meaning of this word in Arabic language in just a moment. He goes on to say, Waqad hadhara ba'd al-kital. He participated in a part of the battle on the day of Ashura. Awalan, which stage of the battle did Imam Zainul Abideen participate in? We don't know. Bidabt. And if you understand the fact that we don't know, you understand how the hands that have manipulated history went above and beyond to conceal the reality of what happened on the day of Ashura. Now what you and I know is perhaps less than percentage of what actually happened on the day of Ashura. Text sarih, text which is absolutely apparent. Qad hadar al-kital, participated in battle. Ba'd, come back to our first word, qad irtutha, meaning what? This is a terminology that is used. This verb is a verb that is used which is equivalent to saying Uthkila bil jirah, yani somebody who's been brought down due to the numerous injuries that he has sustained. When a warrior falls down in battle due to the extensive number of injuries that he has sustained, and he is brought out of the ma'arika, out of the maidan, this is when you say irtutha. So we understand Imam Sajjad participated in battle. Imam Sajjad was heavily injured during this battle and was brought back to the Khaymaga after these injuries. And when you put the Qara'in together, you will find that those ulama within the Hawza Ilmiya that specialize in the world of Makatil, because the Maqtal and understanding the Maqtal in itself is a specialization. Ulama within the Hawza will tell you that when you put together all the Qara'in from the hadith of Fudayl ibn Zubayr al-Rassan and you look at what happened inside of Karbala, the probable sickness description or the probable best closest understanding of the sickness of Imam Sajjad is that he was brought back into the Khaymaga at an early part of the battle because of the injuries he had sustained, with the extensive number of open wounds that were on his body and the extensive bleeding as a result of those wounds, he was overcome with a high level of weakness and fever. There was no water in the tents. There is no form of treatments in the tents. Every other shaheed is dying from their wounds. And in this state, Imam Sajjad has been brought in and is in a level of sickness. And this is where that high level of fever came in. And it is through this means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected Imam Sajjad. For understand, ahibai, we don't take anything. If you understand the shuja'a and the courage and the bravery of Imam Sajjad on the day of Ashura, at the same time, this should not lead you to think, Lord, that everything that is narrated in regards to the sickness of Imam Sajjad is fabricated. Abadan la. In fact, if you understand that Imam Sajjad, courageous as he was, with his sickness, fought in the battle, was injured, you understand the extent of the sickness and the weakness and how frail he must have been from the Asr of Ashura all the way to Sham. Ya Ali, your understanding of the madlumiyat of Imam al-Sajjad becomes much greater. And within this sickness and within this ailments, there was great courage that was shown by Imam Sajjad. Courage on the battlefield, for in essence today has been the shades of courage of Imam Sajjad. One shade of courage you have seen on the battlefield. Second shade of courage for Imam Sajjad. To understand this second shade of courage, I have to visit a hadith of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad wa ajil farajah. Where Khatab al-Anbiya states, Afdalul Jihad Kalimatu Haqq in the Sultan in Ja'ir. The best of jihad is that which jihad? The best of jihad is when a person speaks up truth, Haqq, in front of an oppressive tyrant. It takes courage to speak the truth when you're in front of an oppressive regime. It can take your life and hurt you and execute you and do whatever you want, intimidate you. Understand this hadith. Sah. Now look at how Imam Sajjad applies this hadith. In fact, when we say applies the hadith, he's the manifestation of this hadith. Shufu. Imam Sajjad is coming to Sham. He's in the darbar, in the palace of Yazid al-La'in. Is there any ruler more oppressive than Yazid al-La'in? La. The most oppressive ruler perhaps that the world has ever seen, Yazid al-La'in. So the jihad of Imam Sajjad is going to be not against any normal sultan who is a ja'ir, not any normal oppressor. The person who represents oppression in its entirety, Yazid. Imam Sajjad stands in front of him. In the Darbar Sham, Kalimatul Haqq, is there any greater kalima, words of haq outside of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah Aliyun Waliyullah? Is there any greater word outside of this? La, kalimatil haq. So remember this. You're building up these premises as we get to our natija. The greatest kalima, word of haq. Haq, la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah Aliyun Waliyullah. The most oppressive of rulers, you have Yazid. Over here you have Imam Zainul Abideen coming into the Darbar of Sham. Ahibai, Matamis, understand this. Imam Sajjad is coming into Sham as a prisoner. He is bound in ropes and chains. His women are behind him. His children are crying. The head of his father and the companions of his father are on spears. He has come from Kufa to Sham, burying children one by one across the route. Everything in destiny was against Imam Sajjad. Every tribulation that Imam Sajjad went through stipulates this should be a broken man. When he enters into Sham, not only is he a minority, he enters into a darbar which is absolutely intimidating. He is surrounded by people who have no hesitation in hurling insults towards Rasulullah. He is coming into a darbar where people do not conceal their hatred for Amirul Mu'mineen. He is coming in this out of a circumstance. He is coming in this scenario. Oh, everything is against him. Ishget, how much courage a person needs to have to speak haq at that point. Bound in chains, Imam Sajjad delivered the khutbah. That was so powerful that shook the very throne of Yazid from its core, because the environment of the darbar of Yazid was that they were mocking Rasulullah, saying that today we have taken revenge from Rasulullah for the killing our grandfathers and our ancestors in Badr and in Hunain. These are the people who would hurl insults on Amirul Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib, calling him a khariji. In that environment, Imam Sajjad praised Rasulullah and Amirul Mu'mineen in a manner so eloquent no Shami had ever heard such a description. This is where Imam Sajjad in robes stands up and says, Alhamdulillahilladhi la bidayata lahu. In regards to who is Rasulullah that you people are mocking, ana ibnu makkah wa mina, ana ibnu zamzam wa safa, ana ibnu man humila ala al burak fil hawa, ana ibnu man usriya min al masjid al harami ila al masjid al aqsa, ana ibnu man salla bi malaikati as samaa saffan saffa, ana ibnu man balaga bihi jibrail ila sidrat al muntaha, أنا ابن من دنا فتدلى فكان قاب قوسين أو أدنى فأوحى إليه ربه ما أوحى. I am the son of that Rasulullah who is the son of Mecca and Mina, the son of Zamzam and Safa. I am the son of that Nabi who was taken on Mi'raj on the Bu'ra, on the Burak. I am the son of that Nabi who Jibrail took him to Sidrat al-Muntaha. I am the son of that Nabi who recited Salat and the Malaika were behind him, Safan Safa. I am the son of that Nabi who reached the highest point of existence, Fakana Kaaba Kausaini aw Adna. This Nabi that you are mocking, understand the context in which Imam Sajjad delivered his khutbah. These are people when they were entering into Sham, in the markets of Sham, they were throwing stones on Ali Muhammad. They were throwing firewood on, saying that these are the Kharijis, the children of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Kharijis, take your revenge from Ali ibn Abi Talib by pelting these people with stones. Imam Sajjad in his khutbah showed them this Ali ibn Abi Talib who you were calling a Khariji. Imam Sajjad in his khutbah, when he describes Amirul Mu'mineen, he says, Ana ibn man daraba bayna yaday Rasulillah bi sayfayn wa ta'ana bi rumhayn wa hajara al hijratayn wa bay'a al bay'atayn wa qatala bi badrin wa hunayn wa lam yakfur billahi turfata ayn. I am the son of that Ali ibn Abi Talib who fought between the hands of Rasulullah with two swords. I am the son of that Ali who attacked the enemies of Rasulullah with two spears. I am the son of that Ali who gave the bay'ah twice. I am the son of that Ali who performed the hijrah twice. I am the son of that Ali who killed the kuffar in Hunayn and Badr. I am the son of that Ali who has not done kufr for the blink of an eye. An environment that thrived on the hatred of Amirul Mu'mineen. Understand what Muawiyah did with the Shias of Amirul Mu'mineen. Understand what Muawiyah did to those people who dared narrate a fadila from the fadail of Amirul Mu'mineen. They couldn't say the name Ali in Sham. Imam Sajjad comes and recites the fadail of Amirul Mu'mineen in the middle of Sham. Ahibai, refer back to the khutbah of Imam Sajjad. Hatman, go through the khutbah one by one. 58 fadail recited by Imam Sajjad in regards to Amirul Mu'mineen. I say this a number of times. Yani shay'un ajib wa gharib. They say, why are you concentrating on the fada'il of Ahlul Bayt? Every majlis fada'il of Ali, every this, that. Go and tell Imam Sajjad alayhi salam. The one opportunity he had to stand in front of the kuffar, he made sure each and every ear will hear the fada'il of Ali ibn Abi Talib. This is Deen Ahibai. Amirul Mu'mineen, in essence, was echoing the mission statement of Imam al-Hussein. As we mentioned for a number of the brothers before, Rasulullah or Imam al-Hussein, when he was leaving Medina, in his testimony, which is the mission statement of why he's coming out in Karbala, to Muhammad ibn Hanafiya, kharajtu li talab al-islah fi ummati jaddi Rasulillah, uridu an a'mur bil ma'ruf wa anha anil munkar. Imam al-Hussein says, I'm coming out in revolution for islah, reformation through what? Through amr bil ma'ruf and nahy anil munkar. Tayyib ya Aba Abdullah, How you were going to do this islah through amra bil ma'ruf and nahi anil munkar? Uridu an usir fi sirati jaddi Rasulillah. He says, I'm coming to reform the ummah, to revive the true teachings of Rasulullah. If Imam al-Hussein would have stopped over here, it would have been kafi and sufficient for all of mankind until the day of judgment to understand that the values of Imam al-Hussein when it came to standing up in revolution was to revive the sunnah of Rasulullah. If Imam al-Hussein would have stopped here, it would have been sufficient. But Imam al-Hussein didn't. He said, in addition to this, he said, wa usir fi sirati
Abi Ali ibn Abi Talib, why did you insist, Ya Aba Abdullah, that with the seerah of Rasulullah, there should be the seerah of Amirul Mu'mineen? For the words of Imam al-Hussein, for the world to understand that the only, and I repeat, the only reflection in its truest and purest fiber of the seerah of Rasulullah is the seerah of Amirul Mu'mineen. And Imam Sajjad made this absolutely clear at the heart of the seat of Bani Umayyah. This is courage, this is shuja'ah, this is mine and your Imam Sajjad that we have come to mourn over here. And do not take anything less from his sickness. He was sick and he suffered. He suffered in the way of Allah and his father. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Ahibai, if Masaib goes a few minutes over, I ask you, in the name of Imam Sajjad alayhi salam, bear with me, inshallah, on a night like this, and inshallah, we pray to Imam Zainul Abideen alayhi salam that the hajat that you have, inshallah, are fulfilled even before you leave this center, inshallah. And you leave this center with the barakat of Imam Sajjad, with more than even what you have asked for, inshallah. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Masaib of Imam Sajjad. Allah, Allah. What Imam Sajjad saw in his life, what Imam Sajjad went through in his life. The narrations mention that there came a time where Bani Umayyah was not able to withstand the presence of Imam Zainul Abideen in Medina anymore. They could not kill him or shed his blood openly because they were aware of the consequences from what happened in Karbala. So they decided to kill him through trickery and through silence by administering poison for Imam Zainul Abideen. Arbab al-Makatil mention over here that the intensity of the poison that was given to Imam Sajjad, he felt that his entire insides are on fire. The heat of the poison inside of his body. Imam Sajjad was profusely sweating, sometimes turning towards the right, sometimes turning towards the left. Allah, Allah. On the 25th of Muharram, when Imam Sajjad became Shaheed, the narrations mention that Imam al-Bakir gave him a ghusl and gave him a kafan. The janaza of Imam Zainul Abideen was taken out from the house towards Jannatul Baqi. This is the first Imam who was buried with a public janaza. Every other Imam, him had never had a public ceremony of a janaza. Imam al-Bakir tearfully laid Imam Sajjad down into the grave and covered the grave with dust. Imam al-Bakir returns back to the home bare feet without an amama on his head, weeping and crying. Over here, Darawi says, ask al-Bakir, ask Muhammad al-Bakir, how did he give ghusl to the body of Imam Zainul Abideen? Allah, Allah. Darawi mentions over here, Imam al-Bakir describes what he saw when he was giving ghusl to Imam Sajjad. Today you are with Imam al-Bakir. You are in Medina. You are with the pure body of Imam Zainul Abideen. They ask him, Ya Imam al-Bakir, why is it that you were crying when you were giving ghusl to the body of your father? Imam al-Bakir says, when I was giving ghusl to my father, I saw the entire back of my father was black and blue because of bruises on his back. Allah, Allah, Allah. I don't know, may Allah grant all of you long life. I don't know if any one of you have lost a father or have lost a brother, but giving ghusl to your loved one is one of the most difficult things to do. What about if you're giving ghusl to your father and there are bruises on the body? Allah. Imam al-Bakir says over here, there are two types of bruises on the back of my father. He says the first bruise on the back is because of the weight of the rice and the wheat, the weight from the sacks for the wheat and the rice that Imam Sajjad would carry on his back and distribute the food to the poor people of Medina, the less fortunate in Medina. Imam Sajjad would do this charity work and carry the weight on his back until his back became bruised. They said to him, Ya Imam al-Bakir, what about the remaining bruises on the back of your father? Imam al-Bakir says, when my father was taken as a prisoner from Karbala to Kufa and Kufa to Sham, the manner in which they whipped my father, Imam Zayd al-Abidin.
Allah, Allah, how did they whip Imam Sajjad such that 35 years later, his body is still bruised? Imam Zainul Abideen himself says, when we were traveling from Kufa towards Sham, and the head of my father was on a spear, every time the children saw the head of Abu Abdullah, the children would start crying. When the children started crying, Shimmer would come to me. He would say to me, Ali, if the children don't keep quiet, we will hit you. He says, every time Rukaya cried, Zainul Abideen got a whip on his back. Every time Rabab cried, Sajjado's whip. In one of the makatil I read today, that at one point the children were crying, so Shimar al-Lain came, and with a spear, he hit Zainul Abideen on the head. Oh, why, mama? A Muslim Imam Sajjad. Do you know, from Karbala to Kufa, from Karbala to Kufa and Kufa to Sham, Imam Sajjad was so weak because of the injuries and the ailments. He could not sit on the camel. So then they put him on the camel, which was without a saddle. Every time the camel moved forward, Imam Sajjad would fall down. Sometimes he falls down to the right. Sometimes he falls down to the left. Allah, Allah. Ali, I don't know. My heart tells me, when I hear that somebody falls off the camel, somehow I think about how Abul Fadl al-Abbas may have fallen. Shimar al-Lain comes to Umar ibn Sa'd. He says to him, O Umar, over here Zainul Abideen is falling down. If he falls down at this pace, we will never get our reward from Yazid. He's slowing us down. What should we do? Do you know what they did? Umar ibn Sa'd says, tie Zainul Abideen's feet to the stomach of the camel. This way, if he falls down, the camel is moving. Let it drag the body of Zainul Abideen on the side. Wa Sajjada, Imam Mazloom. Don't ask Imam al-Bakir, don't ask Imam al-Bakir about the bruises on the body of Imam Zainul Abideen. Ba'ad. Imam al-Bakir tells you, when I was giving ghusl to my father, I saw that the wrists and the ankles of my father have scars and cuts on them. Do you know scars and cuts? Why? Because the Maktal mentions that when it came to Imam Zainul Abideen, they tied his feet around the ankle with iron chains, and they tied his hands with iron chains. These chains from the legs and the hands were then tied to the neck of Zainul Abideen. They tied the iron chains so hard they cut into the skin of the. Allah, Allah. Don't ask Imam al-Bakir how he gave ghusl to his father, Imam Zainul Abideen. Ba'ad, Imam Zainul Abideen, Imam al-Bakir will say to you, when I was giving ghusl to my father, Zainul Abideen, do not ask me about the neck of my father. Allah, Allah. Shi'at Zainul Abideen, you know where this part of the Masaib? The Maktal mentions that from Karbala to Kufa, from Kufa to Sham, they put an iron collar around the neck of Imam Sajjad. So the metal chains or the iron chains from the hand were tied to the collar on the neck. The Rawi mentions that there were iron nails that were protruding from the inside. If Imam Sajjad turned his neck to the right, if Imam Sajjad turned his neck to the left, the nails would pierce the neck of Zainul Abidin. To the extent that the Rawi mentions, when Imam Zainul Abidin reached Sham, they tried to open the collar. They could not open the collar. So they began to cut the collar around the neck of Sajjad. The minute they opened the collar, blood came gushing out from the neck. Wa mazluma, Allah, Allah. Don't ask Imam al-Bakir. Don't ask Imam al-Bakir how he gave ghusl to Imam Zainul Abidin. After all these injuries, you ask Imam al-Bakir, he would say to you, I saw bruises on the body of my father. I saw scars on the body of my father, but my tears began to roll down my cheeks when I saw that parts of my father's body are burnt. Allah, there were burns on the body of Imam Zainul Abidin. I ask you how? You take you back to Sh.Mohammed. When the Khaymah was lit on fire, all the women are running out except one. You have over here Bint al-Amir al-Mu'minin, Zainab al-Kubra, running into the Khaymah, running out of the Khaymah. Sajjad is weak. Sajjad cannot move. I don't know how Sajjad got burnt while Zainab was pulling him. Tonight is a night for tears. Tonight I'm not holding back on the Masaib. Ya Shiat Ali Muhammad. The Rawi mentions that at the final moments, Imam Zainul Abidin lay down facing the Qibla. Imam al-Bakir is by his side. Imam al-Sajjad makes him and ordains him as per the command of Allah as the next Imam al-Hujja al-Ma'soom on earth after him. Imam Zainul Abidin gives him the Dhul-Fiqar. He then gives him the Mus'haf Fatima. He gives him the Quran of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib. And then Imam Sajjad says to Imam al-Bakir, you are now the caretaker of the orphan, of the orphans and the women of Bani Hashim. Imam Sajjad then gives him the Ismul A'zam. He tries to urge the Qibla, the beads of death, the sweat of death is dripping down the forehead of Imam Zainul Abidin as he was in his final moments. This is my final part of the Masaib. Ahibai, pay attention over here. Allahu Akbar. The final moments of Imam Sajjad, he was lying down on the ground. As he lay there, Imam al-Bakir came and put his head on the chest of Imam Zainul Abidin. At one moment, Imam Zainul Abidin opened his eyes. He sees Imam al-Bakir's head on his chest. Imam Sajjad begins to weep uncontrollably. He begins to wail uncontrollably. Imam al-Bakir asks him, Ya Abata, oh my father, why do you wail in this manner? Do you know what he said? Ya Shiat Amir al-Mu'mineen. Imam Sajjad says to Imam al-Bakir, how blessed am I that in my final moments I have the cheddar, in my final moments I have the head of my son on my chest. But do you know, in the final moments of my father Hussein, who was on the chest of Abu Abdullah, Allah, Allah, shimmer on the chest of Hussein. From the corner of his eye, Imam al-Hussein looks towards the Khaymaga. He cries out, Zainab, don't look, Zainab. Ya Hussein, matame Hussein, matame Sajjad.
Ya Hussein.
Ya Hussein.
Ya Hussein. Ya Hussein.
Ya Hussein. Ya Hussein. Ya Hussein. Ya Hussein. Ya Hussein. Ya Hussein. Ya Hussein. Ya Hussein. Ya Hussein. Ya Hussein. Ya Hussein.